This is All India Radio in the program Spotlight. Now let's listen to the views of the secretaries of the Finance Ministry on the Union Budget 2021-22, which was presented yesterday in the Parliament by Union Finance Minister Ms. Nirmala Sitharaman.
A very good evening and welcome to this program. Lots of big ticket announcements in budget. Capital expenditure steeply increased to provide, you know, more than 5.5 lakh crore rupees, which is more than 34% more than the budget estimates of 2020-21. Atmanirbhar Swasth Bharat Yojana to be launched with an outlay of more than 64,000 crore rupees over a period of 6 years and lots more. So we'll be discussing all these issues related to the budget. We have with us the Finance and Revenue Secretary, Shri Ajay Bhushan Pandey. Mr. Pandey, let's begin with the fiscal deficit aspect. 9.5% for the current year and 6.8% for the next year. That's what is expected. But don't you think 9.5%, close to 10% of the GDP, isn't that a whopping figure?
The fiscal deficit number has to be seen in a perspective. We are amidst this corona pandemic, which is a very, very unusual. During the last 10 months, this entire country was struck by this pandemic. We had an initial period lockdown, then slowly relaxation,
opening up.
Then economy got impacted, the jobs got impacted, the daily life of people got disrupted. And then thereafter, the economy started coming back to rails and also now showing the signs of recovery. During this period, the government came out with several packages, Atmanirbhar package. In fact, each of those packages could itself be termed as a mini budget. Now, in that backdrop, this particular budget had to come. And this budget could be seen not as an ordinary budget, but this budget is something which can address these problems created by this pandemic situation. And then also that post-pandemic, what will be the kind of economy that we want our country to take to? In which direction our country has to go. This is the first budget of this decade. Also, we are coming close to 75th year of our independence. Now, in this scenario, and particularly in the entire world, the economic order, the post-pandemic is going to be a new order. And in fact, the finance minister in her budget speech has said that in this, the Asia and then also within Asia, the India will have to play a very, very important role. So we have to prepare our country in that direction. Now, in these difficult times, who has the capacity to spend the money? It is the government. Because to expect the private investments alone will be sufficient, the answer is no. So therefore, the government had to come in and spend money. Now, this money is not that the money will get spent in any manner. It has to be a quality spending of money. And that quality is basically, you have seen in the budget, on the health sector, more than 135% increase in the health. The capital infrastructure, 34.5% increase over the last year's one. Similarly, the agriculture. Similarly, if you see the financial sector, lots of reforms, the privatization of two banks and one general insurance company, IPO of LIC, plus monetization of public assets, the land. So all those things, and in addition to that, the simplification of the tax structure, reduction in compliance burden,
increasing the capital. So it's a complete package.
So all those things, and considering that, this 9.5% the fiscal deficit, because we had to spend money, our revenue resources were limited. And then if you see the next year, and then the year after that, we have also given the glide path. It's not that this kind of a money will get spent, this kind of a deficit will be continued for years.
I wanted to come to that point. From 9.5%, very next year you are coming down to 6.8%. So isn't that a huge reduction in expenditure?
Why this is happening is that in the next year, we expect our revenue growth to happen. The tax revenue, we are estimating the increase of 16.9%. Similarly, in the non-tax revenue, this investment is going to give us 1,75,000 crores. So now if you consider that, the expenditure level is almost going to be the level of this year. That is about more than 34 lakh crores. So if that, and with increased revenue collection, we expect that our fiscal deficit will come to the range of 6.8, which is quite realistic.
We are now joined in the studios by Shri T.V. Somanathan, the Expenditure Secretary. And we also have with us Mr. Tuhin Kanta Pandey, his DPAM Secretary. Mr. Somanathan, to begin with you, let's start off with capital expenditure, where we have seen a steep increase of more than 34%, 5.54 lakh crore rupees. What is the basic intent?
The intent is to make sure that we increase the rate of growth of the GDP by kick-starting capital projects which increase our productive capacity, because unlike revenue expenditure, capital expenditure actually makes the economy's capacity to produce larger.
The multiplier.
So it has a big multiplier effect. In fact, economic click studies have shown that the capital expenditure multiplier is somewhere between 2.5 and 4.2, which means that 1 rupee spent by the government can produce an aggregate expenditure of 2.5 to 4.2 rupees in the economy. So when we add, when our capital expenditure is 5.54 lakh crores, it triggers private spending of another 10 to 20 lakh crores. So that has been the logic, that we should actually use government expenditure not just to alleviate suffering, which has been done this year, but also to improve the future rate of growth.
But what about the fiscal deficit, close to almost 10% now? A couple of years back, it used to be a no-no kind of a thing, especially with the FRBM Act in place. But this being a really extraordinary, globally, nationally, in whatever terms. So is it because of that you're going, giving it a go by?
No country this year which has any kind of fiscal targets that would sound like the fiscal targets of 1 year ago. So India is no exception. But in fact, our expansion of our fiscal deficit is smaller than that of many developed countries. And even at 9.5%, I would say it is a very prudent number. And it's been achieved by being careful in the manner that we spent.
And the money is being used.
Even this year, we are exceeding our capital expenditure estimates, even though we have had a very bad year. So we have preserved the quality of spending this year.
Mr. Somnathan, let's also talk about spending with respect to the social sector and also health. What can we expect if we were to talk about health first? Can we see a perceptible change in primary, secondary and tertiary healthcare, not only in big cities and tier 2, tier 3 cities, and also in small villages and at the block level?
Yes, actually one of the announcements that was made in budget is the Pradhan Mantri Atmanirbhar Bharat Swasthya Yojana. Now, the Honorable Minister had read out some of the key elements of that package. Maybe I should just repeat some of them. So actually this is a package that goes from the primary health center up to the apex research institutions in the country. So it intends to support 17,788 rural and 11,000 urban health and wellness centers. So these are basically primary health centers at the grassroots level. But what it also intends to do is to strengthen the, I'm just giving examples, I'm not reading out the whole thing. National Center for Disease Control, which has 5 regional branches and 20 metropolitan health surveillance units. And it also involves creating public health units in every airport and seaport. So it is a comprehensive package which starts at the grassroots level, both rural and urban, and takes it up to the highest national levels of research into virology and all other subjects dealing with infectious diseases. So it's a very comprehensive package. It's a centrally sponsored scheme where states will also join in. So it is, I think, something that will keep us much better prepared, not only for this health emergency that we have faced, but for future emergencies, which may not be of this type, which may not be an infectious disease. It could be some other type of emergency. As somebody said, should not prepare for the last war. We have to prepare for the next war. And that is why we are spending more of the increased health budget on things like drinking water, sanitation, which are the diseases that we face in normal years. Malaria, dengue, diarrhea. These are the big killers in India and which we need to get out of in a non-COVID year. So once we get out of COVID with the vaccine and all the steps that have been taken, there are other health priorities. So it's a holistic package that addresses COVID but also addresses health in a normal year.
Mr. Puleen Kanta Pandey, it's always said that the business of government is not to be in business. So is the government seriously taking forward that philosophy where today the finance minister spoke about IPO of LIC and also, you know, disinvestment target in other companies?
I think she has mentioned, actually she has even named the companies for which the transactions have moved forward. Had it not been for COVID, probably these transactions would have been completed. So probably we will have a little bit of a spillover, but definitely 21-22 she named the transaction that will be completed.
But Air India could not be completed.
Air India would be completed also in 21-22, definitely, because we are trying to do it, close it before March, but it could spill over to April or May in the first quarter.
We are now joined by Sri Debashish Panda, the Financial Services Secretary. Before we discuss the nitty-gritties of the budget, your overall first reaction to the budget?
I think it's a great budget and progressive, forward-looking, growth-oriented, and it has a lot of reforms also in it. And I think without touching the tax structure, hiking or putting a new tax, this budget has been, I think, exceptional. Once in several years you get a budget of this kind, which is clearly focusing on growth orientation and also infrastructure development, which will not only create jobs, but it will also spur the multiplier effect in the economy. And in the long run, I think we are going to be one of the leaders as far as the emerging economies are concerned.
Mr. Pandey, let's also talk about the insurance sector. Big announcement from 49% to 74% for FDI. Will that lead to enhanced investment in the sector?
You see, in a population of our size, there is a need for enhancing social security. Insurance is one of the ways, then pension is another way of providing social security to the citizens of this country. Now, in India, the insurance penetration is quite low. Although in the current government in the last 5-6 years have come out with several micro insurance schemes, like, for example, the Pradhan Mantri Suraksha Bima Yojana, Jeevan Jyoti Bima Yojana. This has, to a large extent, helped in enhancing the insurance penetration. We now need to focus also on the insurance density and move towards other emerging economies, what they have achieved so far. And the insurance is a business where you need a lot of capital. It's capital intensive. So, with the opening up of the FDI, we expect more capital flow will come into the country. They will set up new insurance companies. Secondly, they will bring in the latest technology. They will bring in the best global practices. They will come up with new products. And also, they will enhance the customer satisfaction. So, there will be competition and it's good for the country. And earlier, we had some control that it will be Indian control. That is also being removed so that there are no shackles, so that people come freely, invest here.
We are also joined now by Mr. Tarun Bajaj, the Economic Affairs Secretary. Mr. Bajaj, let's talk about FDI with one specific sector, the insurance sector, from 49% to 74%. Can we expect private companies to usher in this kind of a change in the holding pattern and bring in FDI in a big way?
I think insurance sector is least penetrated in our country. The penetration is very low and it needs a lot of capital for it to grow further. So I think this 49% to 74% would definitely help the insurance sector. And this was also a demand from the insurance sector, especially the players who have come up and set up joint ventures with Indian partners, that because of low capacity or less capacity with the domestic partner, they wanted to bring in more capital. So this would definitely help the insurance sector to a great extent. And while we have extended the FDI from 49% to 74%, I would also, through you, like to assure your listeners that the policyholders' money is safe. It is actually regulated by Insurance Regulatory Development Authority. So where money can be invested, how money can be invested, what extent the money can be invested of the policyholders is actually a decision is taken by IRDA, and the companies have to actually comply with those conditions. So their money is actually safe. So I would say that this is a very nice, good policy that was waiting for many years to come, and finally it has come, and I'm sure it will get us a lot of capital. Earlier also, when the sector was opened up, it got more than 20,000 crores, so we should expect a lot more money coming
in. But Mr. Bajaj, I'm sure you will agree with me that it's been, since the advent of IRDA and opening up of the insurance sector, it's been 2 decades now. But given our demographics, people in our country, they don't go suo moto for taking insurance policies. And still, penetration is much, much less, especially in tier 2, tier 3 cities and rural areas, isn't it? And even if they want to take a policy, they want to go with the government, the LIC, and not with the private sector insurance companies.
What you say is right, and I think that is one of the reasons, and it gives an answer to your question itself, that you need money for these companies actually to open up offices in tier 2, tier 3 cities and reach out to people through agents. And
because insurance is an intangible product. I mean, how would you explain insurance to a villager who is semi-literate, say, for example?
But if you look, the agriculture insurance has actually picked up a lot. So a large number of people are now actually getting their crops insured. And as you said, LIC was actually 100%. Yes. Now it is, I think, almost 70-75%. So a lot of market share has actually been taken
by the private sector.
So we are seeing a lot of progress there.
So that's it in this program on the budget. Thank you so much for joining us. Goodbye.
You were listening to the views of the Secretaries of the Finance Ministry. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.
This is All India Radio. In the program Spotlight, now let's listen to the views of experts and senior government officials on the Union Budget 2021-22.
Hello and welcome to this special program on the Union Budget 2021. We are now joined by Dr. Rajiv Kumar, Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog.
Dr. Rajiv Kumar, almost 2 decades back, the focus was on highways, and we know that Atal Bihari ji focused on the golden quadrilateral. In the budget announcement, a record allocation of more than 1,18,000 crore rupees for the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. Would you say that it's again a renewed focus on highways and roads?
Well, a continued focus is a better way of putting it, simply because this government, since it has come into office, has continued the trust which Atal Bihari Vajpayee ji gave to the construction of national highways and roadways, and also to the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. The new emphasis is that along with the roadways, which have got 1,08,000 crore for capital investment, you've also got 1,07,000 crore for railway infrastructure, which is unprecedented, and which will mean that you will get a new sort of modernized railway system for a new India by 2030, whether it is in terms of high-speed trains or better coaches or the electrification of all broad gauge tracks. So that's the greater part. And similarly, as you know, that we have the flagship corridors and expressways which will be announced for the for the national highways, as also for the railway, the freight corridors, which will be completed by December of 2022. They will provide a huge fillip to the transport and connectivity infrastructure. And then the urban infrastructure, the two new schemes of Metro Light and Metro New, which will be more cost effective, which have been introduced. All of that together means that the physical infrastructure has remained the focus and will continue to be the focus, so that the country can approach towards world-class physical infrastructure in the coming years.
Thank you so much for joining us. And now in the studios, we are joined by Mr. P.C. Modi, the chairman of the Central Board of Direct Taxes. And we also have with us Shri Ajit Kumar, the chairman of CBIC. Gentlemen, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Mr. Modi, if I can begin with you, it's often said that no news is good news. So in that sense, people were probably expecting a huge burden from the taxation point of view, that, whatever you might call it, a COVID tax or cess or anything. But, surprisingly, there was no new additional burden on the tax front.
Certainly,
what would you say?
Certainly, I think that fear of the taxpayers was misplaced, I suppose.
Unpleasantly so.
But what is more important is that despite the pandemic and despite the difficult times, an effort has been to kind of provide much efficient and effective tax administration, something which the taxpayer feels motivated to discharge his tax obligations voluntarily.
And Mr. Ajit Kumar, from the taxation perspective, how do you see it?
I think it's a very positive and a very growth-oriented budget. We are taking forward the Prime Minister's call for Atmanirbhar Bharat. What we are trying to ensure is that our industry, which had suffered a bit during this pandemic time, we try to protect those factories or industries where we can start manufacturing value-added products. So allowing imports of finished products or parts to come in, we have tried to raise duty on those where our own small sector MSMEs are capable of manufacturing these goods, so that due to this protection, they start manufacturing these goods within India.
We want to help them flourish.
Help them. And wherever raw materials are required, we have reduced the rates, because basic raw materials can come in and our industry can start growing. During the pandemic, we found that we were dependent on a certain countries alone. It was possible that when the time when things were well, the industry was doing well. But then that was an eye-opener to us.
And even the PPE kits or the ventilators.
Correct. Those are some of the examples that we had to suddenly rush in. And credit goes to our entrepreneurs, to our manufacturers, that they rose to the challenge. And we said, why not? If we give them the right atmosphere and we give them the protection they need, they can do wonders, and they have done it.
But Atmanirbhar Bharat, many a times, people, it's kind of a misnomer. People tend to see that as if it is a kind of a protectionist move towards the Indian economy, and we won't, let foreign players come. It is actually not that.
No, it is not that at all. We are calibrating the needs of the country, and wherever we need inputs, we are allowing them to come in. But we want to ensure that the country is able to manufacture quality products, make champion sectors, and they are able to export and bring more revenue to the nation.
And Mr. Ajit Kumar, what would you say as far as rationalization of taxation is concerned, especially with the focus on indirect taxation? Although, GST decisions are taken by the council, can we expect, some kind of rationalization in GST, and also those commodities which are outside the ambit of GST, like alcohol, like petrol and diesel, they also come into the ambit?
You have already seen the case of customs. A lot of work has gone in the last past few years, and around 4,000 lines on the customs side we have rationalized. rationalize the tax structure. So the intention of government is to ensure that the taxes are simple and that they follow a certain pattern. There is no inversion of duty so that production can be smooth. That same philosophy of government is also there on the GST side. But then the mechanics are slightly different. We have to go through the GST council. Then the last council met.
But what can the corporate India expect? Wherever there is an inverted duty structure, will the government intervene to set it right?
Yes. So the last council meeting also, this matter had come up and it was discussed. It had come up for discussion. Only it was felt that it's not at the ripe time now to do it. I'm sure in the next couple of meetings that will take place, these issues will come up for discussion.
And now let's go across the Chief Economic Advisor, K.V. Subramanian. For our listeners of All India Radio, tell us, what is your overall assessment of budget proposal?
I think that this budget is a dream budget. I'll tell you why I think that is the case. Firstly, the budget came against the backdrop of a once-in-a-century pandemic that India has really handled it well, and there's a V-shaped recovery that is going on. This budget has taken significant steps to provide fillip to that recovery so that in the coming financial year, India can grow really well at least 10.5% to 11% in real terms, number one. But at the same time, the budget, having been the first budget of this decade, has also laid important foundation for the Indian economy to grow at high growth rates of 8% plus over this decade. It has taken significant steps in that direction. Let me list out what are the key areas that leads me to think that this is such a dream budget. Firstly, if you look at healthcare spending, you know, there's been an increase of almost 140% in the expenditure for health. Do remember that health is a state subject, and so two-thirds of healthcare spending by the government comes from state government. So of the one-third part, there's been a huge increase from the center, almost 2.5 lakh crores provided for healthcare. And this has been provided both for preventive and curative healthcare, because the preventive part comes from sanitation, from clean drinking water, which has been provided for, apart from the curative part as well, where the 65,000 crores approximately Atmanirbhar Swasth Bharat Yojana has been provided for. So that's point number one, healthcare. The second related to that is the provision for vaccination, 35,000 crores. And as I've said in the last couple of days, vaccination is also a vaccine for the economy, because it can really bring people back into economic activities, especially in the service sector. The second important part is the financial sector. Even entering into COVID, the Indian financial sector was facing challenges. There have been several steps that have been taken in the financial sector. The first is the creation of the bad bank in the private sector so that it can be effective. The proposal to divest 2 public sector banks and 1 general insurance company, the proposal to set up development financial institutions within the public sector and to enable development financial institutions in the private sector that infrastructure financing can be provided for, and last but not the least, the insurance FDI limit actually for the insurance sector being raised from 49% to 74% with necessary safeguards about residents being the managers on the board, etc. So the second key part is financial sector. The third is the infrastructure, and as our listeners would certainly appreciate, the infrastructure is really critical, and here roads, railways and power have been emphasized significantly. A 32% increase in infrastructure on a significantly higher outlay this year itself has been provided for. So when you put this all together, also add in the realistic estimates and the transparent budgeting that has been done, I think, you know, it all amounts to a dream budget.
Right, Mr. Subramanian, thank you so much for joining us. And now let's go across to Dr. V.K. Paul, member of Niti Aayog. With you, we will surely, you know, focus on the health sector. We have seen how the provisions have been made targeting the health sector, you know, 35,000 crore rupees for the COVID-19 vaccine. What can the people of this country expect to get free vaccination over a period of time?
This is a budget which will be, you know, going down in the history as you know, a game changer for the health sector, because a big new beginning has been made. and the trend of relatively static or slowly incrementally increasing health budgets, now that trend has been changed to a deep inputs into the budget to raise its trajectory to a totally new level. And that is what is reflected in the budget. Now, the point about the vaccination part of the budget is, of course, very reassuring, first and foremost, and it demonstrates the clear priority that the government is attaching to getting the vaccine to maximum number of people, and also to make sure that resources will not be a limiting factor for ensuring this such an access. So this is, you know, a fulfillment of the promise which the government had made and repeatedly made, that the resources will not come in the way of vaccine availability to the people of India. And that promise has been fulfilled by the finance minister. How we do it is just wait to see. But with this kind of a resource being available, the access to vaccine, and very importantly, as the chief economic advisor was saying, vaccination should not only be seen as saving lives, but also re-energizing fully the economic wheels and the social well-being of the nation.
But Dr. Paul, I'm sure you will agree that, you know, we have never focused on the health sector as such. You know, if we were to see our spending as a percentage of the GDP, but post-COVID, you know, apart from the vaccination thing, post-COVID, do you think now the focus will come back again on the healthcare sector, whether it is primary, secondary or tertiary healthcare in the entire country?
I think you can clearly notice that the focus on health is now central to the government's overall agenda for health, and to make health of the people holistic health, preventive, curative, rehabilitative, all facets of health get the required resources from the state. The public spending will match the expectations of the people in every facet. And therefore, you can clearly see this time around that that push is visible, and this push is there to speak for itself.
We are now joined by the Secretary General of FICCI, Mr. Dilip Shenoy.
Mr. Shenoy, what would you say? We are talking about the fiscal deficit, you know, 9.5% for the current year and 6.8% for the next year. So how easy would it be to bring it down by almost, say, 50% from 9.5 to 6.8%?
No, it's like you also have to remember that we are in a V-shaped recovery. So if you look at the revenue points in the first quarter of next year compared to the minus 23% in the first quarter of this year, the numbers are going to speak for themselves. So you're going to see that. Second is also because the idea of presenting, and you know, the Prime Minister's idea and the Finance Minister's idea of actually getting the budget presented and getting the committees to meet and getting the budget passed very quickly is to start expenditure on 1st April. So that is a point that a lot of people forget. Earlier, you know, it used to take a lot of time to get the expenditure going and to go. Now it's going to happen from 1st April. And you know, very interesting that if you look at the PLI scheme, the scheme is already budgeted here, but all the action and the things would be finished by March. So you'll actually see execution of that, and you'll see things happening. Most of the infrastructure schemes, they have been done in the national infrastructure pipeline. They have been identified. There's a dashboard going on there. So there's a full thing that there will be a revenue increase, and you know that the fiscal deficit could be brought down there. But given the fact we are all talking in the context that the vaccination will be a success, there will be no second round of kind of a pandemic. There are a lot of things there. But, you know, again, the finance minister out of a capital budget has kept 44,000 crores with herself to say that we will use it to do other things. So there is very interesting thing to this budget that should there be something there, we are prepared,
prepared to look at it financially.
And also mentioned there is that she's going to look at ways to incentivize the states to actually invest here. So that's the other thing that they're looking at.
We are talking about fiscal deficit and tax buoyancy and all these issues. We got to know about GST collections for the month of January, almost 1.20 lakh crore rupees. So that's really commendable. Means it's a huge increase. You know, earlier, whenever the GST figure used to cross 1 lakh, we all used to be elated, and it used to be highlighted that, you know, the GST figure has crossed 1 lakh. So can we expect this to be a kind of a sustainable thing going forward?
I'm very positive it's going to be sustainable, because if you look at the amount of money that we are spending on the infrastructure sector, it will have an add-on impact to all, whether it is steel, cement, and other things that are required for both the infrastructure sector. It will really add, and we are pretty confident that the levels of GST collections will remain buoyant, of course, provided there's no second wave
of COVID.
The vaccination program also protects us against all mutants.
So that's it in this program on the budget. Thank you so much for joining us. Goodbye.
You were listening to the views of experts and senior government officials on the Union Budget 2021-22. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com.
This is All India Radio. In the program spotlight, we now bring you a discussion on India-China disengagement in Eastern Ladakh. The participants are Lieutenant General Sanjay Kulkarni, defense expert, and Ajay Banerjee, journalist.
Good evening. We have General Kulkarni with us tonight. And General Kulkarni, we will be talking about the recent developments along the line of active control with China in Eastern Ladakh. The Raksha Mantri yesterday in Parliament made a very balanced statement saying that the withdrawal will be in phases. The first phase will be about withdrawing from North Bank and South Bank of the Pangongso Lake in Eastern Ladakh. The remaining phases will be done within 48 hours, or discussions will start within 48 hours of the first phase. And he also spoke about how the withdrawal will be verified on ground before we move further. Jill Kulkarni, how do you see the development?
A cautious optimism, but a welcome step. Because for the last about 10 months, the tension has been quite high. And hopefully, China should walk the talk. If China does not walk the talk, then all along what we've been saying, that we cannot trust China, it would be proved. So it is a welcome step, and I would see that the tensions which were there along the LAC, it would help minimize, and I was glad to see that at least the armor elements have started pulling back. And that's the first step that the Chinese have done, and simultaneously, we have also done. So it's kind of getting into your own positions by both the sides simultaneously. So that's a very good step that we have done. However, as I said again, a cautious optimism. And in phase one, as what the Raksha Mantri said, that it would be for the Penyangso area, that is both North and South Penyangso, and primarily the North Penyangso, where he insisted that finger 4 and finger 8, that is the area, and the areas that he mentioned was Dansing Thapa. That's where the post office of ours is. And he said east of finger 8, it would be Sirajap 2, 1 or Konark 4, doesn't matter, as long as it's east. And therefore, I think it was very nicely thing, very well said, very well agreed upon. The disengagement does not concede any area of ours, and we are actually emphasizing again and again on the fact that what we said, our perception, the LAC is a perception. Our claim lines and our area is far beyond. But as of now, the LAC runs along finger 8 for us.
To explain to the listeners, what do fingers mean? The fingers are actually spurs of the mountain which end at the north bank of the Pangongso. The Pangongso is a 135-kilometer wide glacial mud lake. General Kulkarni, I will take you northwards towards Gogra Hot Springs in Debsang. How do you see the developments in Debsang? How crucial will the demilitarization of Debsang mean for us? Because Debsang, anything happening in Debsang can hamper the DSDB road, the DBO airfield, and also some parts of Siachen. How do you see that, sir?
I think what you've said actually hit the nail on the head. You know, in phase one, what the Raksha Mantri spoke about was the Penyangso, after which every step will be verified. And after the verification and the disengagement that would have taken place at Penyangso, within 48 hours, the other friction points, like you rightly said, Ostling, Gogra, and the Debsang would be undertaken. Now, as regards the Debsang that you're specifically asking about is, Debsang is an old disputed area where the Chinese were hindering with a patrolling flight. Now, what happened first, earlier, it happened in 2002, and subsequently it happened in 2013, where there was a 20-day face-off, and then the erstwhile Prime Minister underwent, he did sign a treaty, what is called the Border Defense Cooperation Agreement, 2013, and in which it was very clearly stated in Article 6 and Article 8, that firstly, the Article 6, which said, no tailing of petrol. That means the petrol will not be tailed. Article 8 said a self-restraint will be imposed. This was with a view to have peace and tranquility. You are absolutely right. Debsang still continues to be a thing which would have to be discussed in detail. However, in phase 1, Penyangso, and subsequent phases will be Debsang, where what the Chinese are doing are hindering a petrolling to petrol point 10, 11, 11A, 12, 30. So hopefully, that should also get resolved.
To explain to the listeners, these patrolling points numbers are actually the routes decided by the China study group on where the patrol parties will go. These are pre-decided routes. General Kulkarni, when we talk about Ladakh, the LAC in eastern Ladakh, it starts at the east of the Karakoram Pass and ends with Demchok in southeastern Ladakh. Sir, how do you see there are disputed areas, demarcated disputed areas in northern part and southern part? Are these intrusions or are these face-offs, to correct myself, these face-offs which have happened in eastern Ladakh now, are they in any manner China's attempt to unilaterally change the alignment of the LAC, which is anyway the undemarcated?
See, it is primarily because of that. See, the whole thing is, it started off China was never a neighbor. It was Tibet that was our neighbor. And from 1950, after the People's Republic of China, Mao Zedong, that they decided they have captured Tibet, they have captured Xinjiang province, and thereafter now China has become our neighbor. It is when they became our neighbor, it was their perception. They thought they were center of the universe and they could do what they were wanting to do. And slowly and steadily, did capture in 1962 and earlier also slowly and steadily until by 1962, we had already lost what even the Russia Mantri has accepted it to say that we lost 38,000 square kilometers, followed by about 5,165 kilometers being exceeded by Pakistan to China, and then further claiming another 90,000 square kilometers of Arunachal Pradesh. So China has been claiming whatever it be so. And therefore, to say that this is our claim line, see, we, the entire Aksai chain is ours. There's no denying the fact. But the fact is, right now, it is the LAC that matters. And the line of actual control, what we've been saying along, what you rightly said, it comes along from Karakoram and goes up to Debchok along that way. And that is where the perception problems are there. And that is why the various agreements are there in place to ensure that the transgressions do not result in firefights. It does not result in a fist fight. That is it.
General Kulkarni, since you have spoken about the agreements, one of the three key principles which India stresses, both sides should strictly respect the LAC. All pacts must be fully abided with, and neither side should attempt to alter the status unilaterally. So when we talk about all pacts to be fully abided with, I am sure the Chinese were in violation of all the pacts which we have signed since 1993, including the BDCA, which was in 2013, and the previous ones which talked about how the border management will be done, including the border management protocol of 2005. So these pacts have to be sacrosanct. How do you see those?
The Chinese perception of the LAC and our perception of the LAC seems to differ. And therefore, you find that much that we must agree, like what the Raksha Mantri said, we must strictly observe and respect the LAC. If we do not respect the LAC, then the transgressions will take place, and in which again, and once the transgressions take place, then that means we have violated the agreement, we have also violated the status quo which is required to be maintained. And if the status quo has been altered and the agreements have gone to the wind, like in the till what we have done till yesterday, the agreements had gone to the wind. Despite all the agreements that have been signed between India and China, what did they do? They violated the agreements. Even when we talk about finger 8, finger 4, I do hear a lot of people talking about if nobody came in, why are we saying they're going back? It is incorrect. It is all these kind of statements are being made by people who probably are not aware of the ground reality. If you are aware of the ground reality, then nobody would make such a statement to say that if they have not come, why are we saying they have gone back? It is like we were allowed and we were patrolling up to finger 8. That is our perception of the LAC. They were also coming up to finger 4. That is their perception of the LAC. And therefore, now what has happened as per the new agreement, we are gone to Dhansing Post, which is our post. They have gone east of the finger 8. And therefore, between finger 4 and finger 8, there will be no patrolling till such time the peace and tranquility or agreements come into that effect to ensure that peace and no friction takes place. So these are all agreements. Supposing after this agreement, any one of us were to violate it, that is what is wrong. That is why the Raksha Mantri is saying that we must respect the LAC and the status quo must not be altered.
General Kulkarni, the military, of course, we have spoken very eloquently. Mr. Rajnath Singh and the Foreign Affairs Minister of Affairs, Jayashankar, were in Moscow in October. There were face-to-face meetings with the Chinese counterparts out there in Moscow over these very issues. There was talk about de-escalation. Sir, I'm sure there's a lack of trust, especially at the ground level between the two armies. How do you see that trust being built up if this goes through? Because I am saying with a big if this goes through, as you say, the caution is there still. How do you see the trust being built up again?
That is exactly what was worrying everybody, because there is total lack of trust, because the Chinese have done what they were not supposed to do. But they did it. They have actually stabbed us in the back, what they did. We have mobilized in such a manner and quick that they did not probably expect that India would react in the manner that they have reacted, resulting in what has happened now, the disengagement by the Chinese, because they thought there was that shoe more than they could bite. Now, as a result of which, this, all these things have taken place. Because of this trust deficiency that exists, thank God that at least in part of the disengagement, now we find the armor columns are moving back, we'll find the people will start moving back, we'll find the infrastructure has been done away with, you know, all the areas of dispute. This is primarily to ensure that at least, as I see, we have all along ensured and abided by the agreements that have been signed between the two countries. It was China which had violated. Now it is the responsibility of Chinese to ensure that they sort of come up in a manner that they, at least their actions should show that we can trust them. Because trust we must, but verify we must. Trust but verify. And that is what I would say for the Chinese.
General Kulkarni, all of us who cover these strategic affairs know that the terrain on the Chinese side is very simple. It's a flat Tibetan plateau. They can deploy very quickly. On our side, the terrain is not so friendly to us, and we will need to cross at least 2-3 high mountain passes just to get the equipment back there at the locations. How do you see this scenario building up if China comes back again? Will it surprise us? How do you see that threat being tackled by the Indian Army?
See, firstly, mountains favor the defender. We must be, and therefore, the Indians are on a very, very dominating position wherever they are. And certain places, like when we talk of Pengangso, it's almost an infantry battle that would take place at Pengangso. When we talk about the Chushul area, the Sangur Gap, again, it is infantry and mechanized. But at Depsang, it's primarily the mechanized, which is going to be in a large measure. So with the kind of technology that we have and the kind of equipment that we have today, it is not going to be easy. The Chinese are aware of it, that they cannot, it is not 62 number one. Secondly, we have far more capacity building that has risen so much, and the way the Indian troops have actually shown themselves with the kind of determination and the spirit and be able to confront the Chinese itself has put the Chinese in the back foot. But yes, we have to be careful, we have to be vigilant, we cannot take China for granted, and we must not be lulled into complacency whatsoever.
Sir, how do you see the things going forward? Because as the Raksha Mantri statement is very categorical that after the first round is done, the first phase is done, then we will have to go to the second rounds. Those will include Gogra Hot Springs and Depsang, of course. How do you see this going forward? What could be the precautions India could take?
First and foremost, most of it, even if we give ourselves 7 days, I think within about 7 days, everything will be known. Because what the Raksha Mantri said, that as soon as the actions are over, within 48 hours, the next phase would take place. So the Nyangso phase, which we should not give more than 3 or 4 days for it to happen, but give it 7 days also, even if it is to happen, because after every step, verification, again, they would take a step, again, verification, presuming it would be 7 days. And at least in the next 10 days, positively, we would know how the phase two goes. Because if the Chinese were not to walk the talk, and they've only said this, and it's a smoke screen created by China for their good, because they have heavily mobilized. There are 4 mechanized infantry divisions, the 6 motorized infantry divisions. All of them are already there in their locations, and they get quickly mobilized. It is not that they cannot do it. They know where they are. We also know where exactly they are. And amassed troops to a large extent is all the artillery and missiles, and all these tanks and mechanized columns are all good to go back there in the concentration area. But it is for Chinese now to show their intent, that their intent, they actually want peace and tranquility. They want good relations with India. The onus is entirely Chinese, and most of it would be seen in the next about 10 days.
General Kulkarni, how far do you think that India and China, they have avoided this situation? We were in a very serious situation in 2022 because bullets were fired, people were injured, there were physical clashes, and there were so many things happening which had not happened since probably 1967. That is almost 53 years ago. So in these 53 years, the trust, of course, has been broken, the agreements have been breached. Do you see that these two countries, if they have to progress ahead, should demarcate a kind of LAC on the ground? If I remember correctly, the demarcation of the LAC has been discussed multiple times, including at the special representative talks. How do you see this happening? Can there be a demarcation of the LAC?
We have had numerous talks. I would say how many kind of meetings that have taken place on the working mechanism for consultation and coordination, military commander talks, so many talks that have taken place whatsoever. We have not once exchanged the maps. Can you imagine that we have not once exchanged? The Chinese are not willing to give the maps because their perception line changes, their claim lines change. So it's very difficult. The Chinese of 14 countries that they have land borders with, they have not sorted out with 2 countries, India and Bhutan. That means whatever be it, the Chinese can't be trusted. The Chinese will continue to apply as much pressure as they can. The Chinese would want to nibble slowly and steadily whatever area that they seem to feel. So it is very important for us to be able to deal with China from a position of strength. And that strength has to come from military, that strength has to come economically, and that strength will give strength to diplomacy. So it is very essential to deal with China. We have to deal with from a position of strength. There is no question. We should not and we will not buckle under any kind of pressure that the Chinese would want to apply. Now, the only thing that I see, Ajay, over here is the Chinese are not going to get into a kinetic war or a kind of a confrontationist war with India, but they would now use Pakistan, which happens to be their proxy and rentier state of China, for using all kinds of non-kinetic and kinetic energy you find will be done from the Pakistanis. The Pakistanis will be confronting and the Chinese will be only applying pressure. So this we have to be prepared for.
The last few hours have been very crucial in India-China relations. We have started a disengagement process at the Pangongso Lake. And the Raksha Mantri, Mr. Rajnath Singh, has informed the parliament that this will happen in phases. I hope it is going now good. General Kulkarni, thank you for talking to us.
Thank you.
You were listening to a discussion on India-China disengagement in eastern Ladakh. The participants were Lieutenant General Sanjay Kulkarni, defense expert, and Ajay Banerjee, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com. This is All India Radio. In the program Spotlight, we now bring you a discussion on Finance Minister's reply on budget discussions in Parliament. The participants are Shubhamoy Bhattacharjee, economic analyst, and AIR correspondent Sonu Sood.
Replying to the budget debate in Parliament, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman said the Union Budget 2021-22 aims to attain sustainable growth for an Atmanirbhar Bharat with enhanced allocation to key sectors. And she also stressed on continuing focus on uplifting the poor. She talked about the government's and Prime Minister's commitment to development, growth, and reforms. Shubhamoy, how do you see this budget being an impetus for growth and helping India become one of the fastest growing economies in the world?
First of all, by any reckoning, this budget has been probably the most significant budget which has been presented for several years. Why do we say so? Because this budget has recognized some fundamental elements of the Indian economy which holds great potential. For instance, this budget accepts that the government has no business to be in the business of running and businesses. So the government has said, for instance, that it will not just disinvest, which was already an accepted phenomenon, but more than that, it has set into process a clear direction of selling assets that it holds which is not being used, like land, also assets which were being used badly, like many of the loss-making units, which are also profitable. But there's no reason why the government should be running it. Instead, the private sector can run them better and make better use of them. These are the assets like roads, ports, airports. You know, basically, the government has said that we run process of what is called the asset monetization, which means that the private sector will be running these assets and using further deeper efficiency gains to create benefits for everybody concerned. Then get the money that it generates from those sales to invest in sectors where there's a need for capital sector, for investment in further, you know, building up of infrastructure, in building up, again, social infrastructure, both hard and soft, and so on and so forth. So these by themselves are so significant that they have actually made everybody sit up and take notice. Second part is that the government has also said that it will not, therefore, get into the business of asking people to pay more taxes. Because what it has done is it has said that whatever taxes we have, those taxes will stay. There is a continuity in the taxation. These two together essentially create a very strong reform blueprint, which has been the significant feature of Budget 21-22.
Shubhamoy, in fact, what you said, that the assets which are non-productive right now or which have much more potential, they will be put to use by privatization and the overall wealth creation will be given a boost. So you think that is also important, even if we see from the vulnerable sections point of view, because even in the economic survey, it was said that the entire pie has to increase, the wealth has to increase so that it can be distributed among even those who really need it.
You know, we often, obviously, as a developing country, we know that there is plenty of need. There are lots of people in the low-income bracket, people who need support. The COVID has created the exposed shortcomings in many of the sectors. Now, to do all of that and more doesn't mean that the government should start doing everything. What the best course is for the government to accept that the economy can create measures to help everybody out, provided the government puts in place policies which are smart. And this budget is therefore has worked in that direction. For instance, the clear understanding that you cannot just be riding on just public sector-led growth. There's no particularism out here. It is simply an acceptance that creating more and more public sector companies isn't necessarily the way the public is served. So those are the things that have been accepted.
In fact, the finance minister has, you know, talked about the budget taking consideration for and showing respect towards all citizens, be it the bottom rung, the taxpayers, or the wealth creators. So can you just give your take on this statement, which seems to allay many of the doubts which have been raised by the various parliamentarians during the debate?
If the government, for instance, says that I will give out more benefits by handouts, because what would it do? That is what seems to be lots of people often mistake as government support. When those handouts are given, somebody somewhere has to pay for those handouts. And those handouts are then, they are financed by raising taxes or they create inflation. In both cases, they create whatever is giving out as handouts essentially ends up not helping the people because the amount of support that comes is much less than the amount of distortion that it creates. For instance, the scheme to help the Swanidhi scheme, to help the people who are at the lowest income group, which is basically those who sell hawk products on thelas, on rickshaws, these sort of people, you are not going to help them by giving them a one-time support. Instead, it's a better thing by giving out a loan. Now, it might seem a difficult thing, but it is practical because what it does is it creates an incentive for those people to in products which will give them a sustaining income year over year. It cannot, these schemes should not be financed by moneylenders and others who skim them. When the government gets into the business of helping them and the government stays away from trying to run overarching companies which can be run by the private sector. So, for instance, the government should be, for instance, be helping the poorest people, but should not be in the business of running an airline or running a huge railway network. How does it help? The government will be much better off helping those who really need it rather than trying to do these sort of massive mega things, which creates a distortion in the market. And that is what the government this time has clearly understood that it needs to avoid.
In fact, the SM detailed the various measures government has rolled out to help the poor and vulnerable, starting with Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, which had free ration, cooking gas, cash transfers to women, senior citizens, because that was the need of the hour at that time when COVID had just struck. But they have also talked about Swanidhi Yojana, as you were saying, about street vendors, PM Awas Yojana, where more than 1.7 crore houses have been completed, Saubhagya scheme, where 2.6 crore households have been electrified. So you think living standards of these people, and they are forward looking.
The whole idea is, again, the government should not be getting into things. This budget also should be read with the current monetary policies that have also been unveiled by the Reserve Bank. Both of them very heavily are looking at policies which are needed to be done when the economy is in crisis, by, for instance, helping the MSME sector. Now, again, the point about helping sectors, as we have found out during COVID, and which, you know, lots of countries tried initially on by giving huge policy, huge financial support, was that they said that we'll give cash those. As it turned out, that the crisis kept on getting worse and worse, and there was a limit to how much cash dole that could be given. Many of the, for instance, countries in Europe and even USA is finding that you just can't keep on giving that sort of a support endlessly. Instead, India came into the business a bit later of giving what is called supply-side support. This is much more useful. As I said, what it does, it depends on the people's ability to generate income. And frankly speaking, if we look at the indicators of the economy, what are they showing? Right now, for instance, over the past few months, the index of industrial production, instead of, you know, getting into crisis, is actually showing improvement. The levels of deposits in banks, they have not only climbed back, but credit from banks has again started to move northwards. Take other examples, indicators of what's happening in the economy. Exports have started, despite a difficult climate, have started showing impressive numbers. Unemployment, which had been expected to go through the roof, by all indicators, it is bad, but is actually not worse than what it was in the first quarter of last year. Rather, it has come off rather well, and it is actually showing signs of stabilizing. Essentially, what it is showing is, therefore, that the that in every measure, the economy is turning out to do better. It is not the time now to try tough major demonstration effect and again create a problem. Rather, it is necessary to help the economy repair itself. This budget is essentially doing that job very well because it doesn't do any flamboyant exercises of trying to move resources from one sector to another. And that is what was needed. It instead does a very good homework of saying what the government has, where the government shortage of money is. It has made itself very clear. Because it has made it very clear, the market has started trusting the government numbers. You know, this is very important because if it doesn't happen, then when government raises credit, the inflation rate, bond yields rise, there are all sorts of things that happen, which we can't go into in this case, in this such a short discussion. But it makes economic agents within the country and abroad start suspecting the government's arithmetic. And when that happens, the government's ability to control the fiscal measures and tamp down on inflation, which is so necessary.
Shubham, you just now talked about that, you know, budget which has not been seen in several years. What stands out is that capital expenditure on infrastructure has been increased by 35%. Health infrastructure expenditure has been increased by 137%. And there's a lot of talk about this multiplier effect of capital expenditure. Can you just explain in simple words what is this multiplier effect and how will it impact the economy in the short term, medium term and long term?
Simply this way, that let's take the example of point about helping the poorest by running their enterprises. If in the short term, if they are given help rather than giving doles, then they are able to start recouping their ability to begin earning. It helps them in the medium term by being able to further borrow because they know that there's a scheme under which they can keep on borrowing and therefore repaying the sources from where they are taking the money. And that creates a, what is called a multiplier effect as more and more of them are able to create this sort of a business starting from scratch.
The expenditure on roads, railways, the physical infrastructure of the country, that is also going to create jobs, generate incomes, generate demand?
Certainly. I feel that the support when it happens through using means which the government can do rather than trying complicated stuff which the government cannot do, the economy is better off. Certainly, as I said right at the beginning, that asset monetization, which means that the government keeps on building infrastructure, roads, ports and all those things, and then keeps on selling them, creates the virtuous cycle of money, which then can be used to help the poorest. That is the way this budget is expected to operate. And this is something which most commentators had been asking the government to get into for a long time. And it is, and after trying for several years, it's not as if this will be started now. Monetization has already shown tremendous success, which is why it is a route the government through which the government has already earned something like 80,000 crores. It's a route through which there's a tremendous promise and which can be further deepened in the years to come.
Shubham, this budget is also unusual in the sense that there were four mini budgets before this February budget came because of the COVID situation. So you feel that given the unusual COVID situation, the fact that so many budgets have come, mini budgets as we can say, relief measures have come periodically, it has been the right strategy for the government?
Of course. You know, basically, this is the year when there is so much, what should we say, shattering of output because of COVID. And because of that, most governments across the world are desperately trying to find out ways to sort of put the economy back on rails. The measures that the government has taken over the past few months, and that's something which is very significant, has actually helped considerably. And that's what is making, if you look at commentaries by rating agencies like Standard & Poor's, that also saying the same thing, that yes, these are the ways to go about it. So we can be most pleased about the set of measures. Obviously, within this, there will be certain things that will not be perfect. For instance, we can have questions about whether the government will really be able to do things like asset reconstruction companies or even DFI, the development financial institutions. But then those are some things on which we shall have to, something that will have to be seen out. But the very blunt refusal to look for redistribution through using more and more taxation and fiscal transfers and instead going in for a clear economic policy, which says that it will not be based on handouts, but will be based on making all parts of the economy function better, is what makes this budget stand out.
Thank you so much, Shubham, for this in-depth discussion.
Thank you.
You were listening to a discussion on Finance Minister's reply on budget discussions in Parliament. The participants were Shubhamoy Bhattacharjee, Economic Analyst, and AIR Correspondent Sonu Sood. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.
This is All India Radio. In the program Spotlight, we now bring you India's stellar role in tackling COVID-19 pandemic, an interview with WHO representative in India, Dr. Rodrigo H. Offrin. The interviewer is AIR Special Correspondent, Dr. Atul Kumar Tiwari.
Welcome to this edition of our special series on India-UN partnership to mark 75th anniversary of United Nations. Listeners may recall, India is one of the founding members of the world body. Today, we have with us Dr. Rodrigo H. Offrin, the WHO representative in India, to tell us more about the role of the world body and how it's working in close coordination with the government agencies in India. Welcome to the show, Dr. Offrin.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Offrin, the year gone by has been a challenging year for mankind, physically, emotionally, as well as financially. The COVID-19 pandemic and its aftermath have really dealt a major blow to the health systems across the globe. Let me ask you, what has been the response so far and if it has been effective enough in tackling the challenge?
It's not known to many people that a big part of the WHO program is actually a pandemic preparedness. So there were capacities being built in different countries at different levels. We were not starting from zero in all countries, including India. There are lots of capacity, but the issue is that this pandemic is really beyond the scale of anyone can imagine. We did not have the same scenarios in mind. WHO helped forge unprecedented partnerships with countries, scientists from the most leading academic and research institutes, industry and philanthropies, that has become a blueprint for global response to future health emergencies and pandemics. And lastly, a big part is maintaining health services and supporting health systems. Other non-COVID health services needed to continue, whether they were for maternal child health or vaccination or even TB care. To end this pandemic, the response cannot always be in the hands of experts or doctors or clinicians, but in the hands of the public. So the COVID-appropriate behaviors, as we call them in India, is the most important response, especially up to now. If we're able to do the 3 W's of washing our hands often, wearing a mask, and watching out our distance from crowds, this helps stop the transmission of the disease.
A lot of questions were asked and are still being asked about the role of WHO in whether the world body has lived up to its expectations, whether the spirit of collaboration, has it really worked?
WHO is an organization of member states. Countries are the members of this organization. So to ask if WHO has really lived up, it's also up to our member states who have been participating in this whole response. As staff, our secretariat to the member states in this regard, and as I told you, this is how we managed the response and putting a frame to the response globally so that the pandemic can be consistently addressed everywhere. Collaboration has worked, definitely. I think just to have a picture right now in terms of whether it was information being shared, samples being shared, countries openly reporting about their cases, we have seen that this is happening everywhere, and countries are very much participative in this collaboration. I talked to you about the ACT Accelerator. That has come from collaboration of so many countries in terms of having tests and therapeutics in trials. We call them the solidarity trials, and they're in multiple locations in many parts of the world to share that information so that we're able to have evidence for our upper response. As the pandemic was spreading and as also the countries were starting to open after the lockdowns, the sharing of resources, provision of supplies, opening airways and air lanes and airlines so that deliveries of the essential supplies were happening was also happening in countries. So this is all happening. Collaboration has worked and will continue to needs to be the cornerstone for preparedness and capacity building for future-proofing the world from future pandemics.
As the COVID-19 pandemic spread globally, it has also affected several ongoing healthcare programs and initiatives towards meeting the achievements of SDGs. Has it cast a shadow specifically on SDG number 3?
And I'll bring you back to one of the core pillars of our response, which is maintaining essential health services, meaning that no other health services should stop because the resources and a focus of such is towards ending the pandemic. It did happen. Many of our healthcare workers were deputed to manage whether they are wards or primary health centers, or if they are designated, if they become designated COVID hospitals, or even surging capacities for laboratories. For many of our medical technologists, there was a focus on that at the outset. But right away, we were all saying that this should not happen. We should not witness, for example, a cases or an outbreak of diseases that already have a vaccine that's proven for them. Let's say polio, measles, etc. That should not happen. So yes, there was a setback initially at the outset, but because of the efforts of many governments and our discussions with them to how to do this, services continued. Routine immunizations have not stopped. There may have been delays in the big subnational immunization drives, but that's now back all on schedule. And the government of India and health services have done very well. So to your question, yes, there is a bit of a setback, but it was also an opportunity to reinvigorate and innovate. And in the larger future, we should be able to see achievement of SDG 3 with a lens in which it will be a health system that is resilient to any other public health emergency or big emergency.
Listeners, we are in conversation with Dr. Rodrigo H. Offrin, WHO representative in India, on the role of world body in tackling the challenges in COVID era and its association with India. The vulnerable groups, the poor, migrants, weaker sections of the society, the women and the children, they have suffered most. Have we assessed the impact and how does it augur for the future?
Indeed, COVID-19 has exposed gaps in certain sectors of society, including women and children. Globally, we have also seen that it has exposed gaps in public health delivery at global, national, subnational level in different countries. In 2020, children and adolescents under 18 accounted for around 8% COVID-19 cases, although they comprise 29% of the global population. So if you look at it, that's why the focus on COVID-appropriate behaviors is primarily also on the youth. That's why the governments have really made efforts to ensure that there is no denial of essential health care, especially for child and maternal services.
It is said that the challenging times require equally forthright a response. We have seen how the doctors, the health workers, the nurses, the ASHAs, ANMs, paramedics, sanitation workers, and others, frontline workers, have really worked hard as corona warriors in meeting these challenges. COVID-19 pandemic has seen how a unified effort can really overcome these challenges. How can we further strengthen them?
One is very good training for healthcare workers. Two, providing them the necessary protective equipment as needed. Having an infection prevention control program in health facilities is another. So there should be a supportive environment for your healthcare workers. The other is career tracks. We have public health servants, public health staff who are working in emergencies as surveillance officers, as contact tracers, etc. What is their track towards a public health emergency track? Maybe that's another way to keep having a workforce that is resilient to any possible emergency. The other more important thing also is their own welfare, their mental health, the kind of counseling and support that healthcare workers get. So that all needs to be planned.
The future really holds in store what we call the reimagining of the healthcare system. We have seen how India has been able to bring down the number of active cases. What would you attribute this to?
It is about fundamental public health responses and actions, which is summarized, of course, you've been hearing this a lot, detecting cases. What is your surveillance system out there? Your contact tracing. How do you get their contacts fast? And the testing, because right away you have to be able to test and know whether people are positive or not. And therefore, the next point is isolate and care. So throughout this pandemic, I've seen that in India, as far as possible, all the states were pushing for this. This was our key advice. It's really pushing for this areas of public health response. As we moved further, we also saw that India became self-reliant with a lot of these supplies. So it provisioned an easy access of PPEs, of essential equipment, essential medicines to support the whole response. The use of technology is something we also saw. You had Arogya Setu as an app that was a proximity app to get people to know what's going on. The Prime Minister himself has called for a Jan Andolan on COVID. So the whole response is moving quite well. And now also a very concerted, meticulously planned, meticulously rolled out vaccination drive. This is another kind of remarkable response from the country.
In a post-COVID world, the focus is now on vaccines. India has already started the world's largest vaccination exercise. How is its progress going on, and how is WHO supporting in this endeavor?
Vaccination is one of those public health responses. First of all, it's a remarkable thing that several vaccine candidates have been developed within a year of this pandemic. If you're asking about our role, we have been involved in this, and I keep thanking the teams in WHO that have been involved in this for some time now, and we have provided technical guidance, including sharing of technical materials for vaccine development right at the outset. That was what WHO was providing. Track the task forces in their regular meetings, provide issues that need to be discussed. In this whole preparatory phase, we have been side by side with Ministry of Health in terms of refining the operational guidelines that have been rolled out and which you will see uniformly implemented there in every PHC or vaccination site. Trainings have been conducted. The development of training materials specific to the India health system. We have identified rapid response teams for deployment to support vaccination response, because we do have a role as WHO in terms of, as provided by government, in terms of monitoring the session site. Are they up to the standards and the operational guidelines issued by the Minister of Health and Family Welfare? We have also provided some support to the communications that go out to provide the technical vetting for some of the messaging.
Dr. Afin, last but not the least, you have been closely involved in emergency preparedness on behalf of WHO, and you have handled several emergency situations. How do you look at this COVID pandemic in the years to come? What lessons has it conveyed to us as a humanity?
I think the overarching lesson for all of us is something on humility. That, no one country, no one expert, no one ministry knows everything at any point in an emergency. We should never assume. The pandemic has hit hardest at countries that supposedly had very, very good health systems and medical systems. And that's a learning for all of us. We should see that also that resilience is something that you constantly learn. So that's probably the second lesson. That as this response was ongoing, we were all learning. Now India is contributing to the world response, which is so commendable, whether it is for PPE equipment provision, essential medicine provision, but also the vaccines. I think that's so commendable that India has come out providing vaccines to neighboring countries. And also together with it, the information platform in which this may be rolled out is something for being offered for other countries to consider. So from a responder for the country to a responder to the world, India as a not just a pharmacy for the world, but also a responder for the world, providing all that support to other countries, our neighbors practically first, and then I'm sure it will redound to a larger impact on ending the pandemic. So in essence, from this pandemic, I think a better prepared India is a prepared world. We have seen this in terms of the contribution now of India to the response.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Afin. Well, listeners, that was Dr. Rodrigo H. Offrein, WHO representative in India, sharing his insights into the shape of things to come in the wake of COVID-19 pandemic and the role of WHO for and its quest for a better and healthier future for mankind. Thanks for joining us.
You were listening to an India's stellar role in tackling COVID-19 pandemic, an interview with WHO representative in India, Dr. Rodrigo H. Offrein. The interviewer was AIR Special Correspondent, Dr. Atul Kumar Tiwari. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.
This is All India Radio. In Spotlight, now we bring you a discussion on guidelines for social media platform. The participants are Jiten Kumar Jain, cyber expert, and Aditi Tandon, journalist.
The government today released a very important set of new guidelines that will regulate several social media platforms, digital news platforms, as well as the over-the-top platforms. And this was a much awaited set of guidelines, Mr. Jain, as we all know that Information Technology and Electronics Minister, Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad, had in the first part of the budget session apprised the parliament that one such set of guidelines is about to come. And the need was felt for a long time because there was a sense within the social media community and also among the consumers that there is an absence of grievance redressal mechanism. So the new guidelines now put into place a number of measures whereby the social media platforms and intermediaries will have to actually respond to consumer complaints and also complaints from the government with respect to unlawful content. What do you have to say on the broad framework of these guidelines?
I think what government has done, they have tried to find a very fine balance between self-regulation, oversight, and sort of ensuring that how these big giants are bought into some sort of governance control and to ensure that they comply with the law of the land. So if you look, what government has done is that they have now differentiated in the new draft IT rules between the social media intermediaries and the significant social media intermediaries. So what they have said is that a social media platform which has got more than 50 lakh customers in India or users in India would be labeled as a significant intermediary, and they would have to do some additional compliances. For example, they would then have to now appoint three officers, the compliance officer, grievance officer, and a nodal officer in India, which should be available 24/7. And he has to be a resident of India. He can be a foreign person, but he has to live within India. This is to do away with the problem that these platforms were not complying with Indian law. Most of their grievance officers were sitting in some countries like Ireland. They would not respond for several days. So to do away with this problem of timely compliance and non-compliance, government has ensured that these significant social media intermediaries would now have to have these three people based out of India. At the same time, to ensure that there is no stifling of innovation or there is no extra regulation or problems created for small startups or innovators who are just trying to build new businesses. So the people who have got platforms which have got less than 50 lakh users, they can continue to do the business in the normal fashion. All the restrictions and the sort of additional compliances are coming for the new platforms. Second, the government has said that if there is any content which is bought in the notice of these platforms by a court order or a government order or through any lawful order, that content would have to be blocked, restricted or taken down within 36 hours. If any user approaches this grievance officer, especially in the cases of revenge porn or obscene content or blackmailing content and stuff, these officers will have to respond to those complaints within 24 hours. So I think this is a very fine way of empowering users. Government is also saying that if these social media platforms, sometimes they're acting on their own free wills and fancies, they suspend account of users, they take down content, they restrict their posts, they do some sort of shadow bans. If there is any moderation or blocking or restriction of any user's content or his account, these platforms will now have to inform that user. They will have to give him an opportunity to appeal that order, and if that user is not satisfied within a month of the resolution with this social media platform, he can always approach the government.
I had to ask you about a very important part of the social media regulation guidelines released today, where the government is saying that intermediaries providing services primarily in the nature of messaging, for instance, WhatsApp, also Facebook, would have to enable the identification of the first originator of information on its computer resource. Mr. Jain, I'll take you back to 2 years when you remember there was a kind of an epidemic on WhatsApp of fake messages, after which a lot of law enforcement challenges had arisen. Even at that time, this debate had been initiated that WhatsApp should disclose the source of the information from where is the unlawful content being originated. But WhatsApp, contrarily, had taken a position that they protect the privacy of users. And since all conversations are end-to-end encrypted, they would not share with the government as to where did the unlawful content actually take birth or originate. So how will the government comply with this? I mean, how will the legal guarantees be put into place to ensure that WhatsApp complies?
In last 3-4 years, we have seen the growing nature of political conversations over social media, growing politicization of social media, where 70% of conversations today are on political topics, which has led to extreme views, sometimes degrading political discourse, fake news, rumor mongering. Now, there is another thing what we have seen in last couple of years is that foreign powers are running propaganda campaigns within India using information warfare by running several fake news websites, posting rumors about our policies to incite violence within India. Now, what government is trying to do, they are bringing in sort of a guideline or a rule within this notified draft today, whereas they are saying that if any fake news, rumor or something, unlawful content is found on these platforms, government by court order or by a lawful order can ask these platforms, including WhatsApp, to disclose the identity of the first originator or the uploader of that content. There has been, a confusion in this conversation when it comes to WhatsApp and other platforms which are end-to-end encrypted, which are instant messaging platforms. I think there are some people who are trying to spread rumors that government is now asking these companies to provide a backdoor or their chat history and stuff. I think the laws make it very clear that government is not looking for their chats or personal conversations. All government is looking is for metadata and the identity of the first user who uploaded a particular URL, a link or a video, which WhatsApp can easily trace. For example, when you forward a message several times, these days you see that this message has been forwarded so many times and all those things. So WhatsApp does keep a track of metadata. WhatsApp does know the identity of the first uploader of that content. I think government is looking for that very little metadata to establish the identity of the propagators and originators of those content.
I think what you said is also something which the IT minister made very clear today when he was announcing the new guidelines, when he actually stressed that the social media intermediaries would have to reveal details of the first originator of the mischievous post and no other important details or nothing else related to any kind of chat history. As you said, only metadata is required. But again, the issue comes back to whether WhatsApp and Facebook and Twitter would comply, because we have undergone a lot of problems on account of fake news being peddled through WhatsApp and through Facebook. And we saw recently last week how Facebook managed to actually strike a deal with the Australian government when the Australian government was planning a law asking Facebook and Google to pay up for hosting news links on their platform. So it's not easy to get them to comply. What I want to understand is what kind of a legal guarantee will the system have to make WhatsApp and Facebook and Twitter comply with our orders?
I think there is this growing discourse and phenomena across the world where, take the case of Australian government's dispute with Facebook, where Facebook and Google are refusing to pay to the Australian news media outlets. They are refusing to comply with Australian law. Or you take the example of Twitter refusing to comply with the lawful orders of Indian government last month to take down certain fake accounts posting violent content. Or then issues of Twitter trying to be banned in some African countries on the charge of influencing elections. So I think there is a growing concern and phenomena where these big techs like Facebook, Twitter and Google are refusing to comply with the local laws. Now, it is in that context, even today, Minister made it very clear during the press conference that, look, WhatsApp has almost 50 crore users in India. And I think if you look at the whole spectrum of the social media networks, I think almost around 40% users come from India. They make huge money from India. Now, there cannot be a case that these platforms can think that our laws, our sovereign parliaments are subservient to their business policies, which is why Minister was saying that they're welcome to do business in India, they're welcome to have users, they're welcome to make money, but they cannot refuse to not comply with the law. They cannot spread anarchy in the name of defending free speech. They cannot have dual standards. When a US Capitol is attacked by mobs and angry protesters, you suspend thousands and thousands of accounts. Whereas in India, where there are violent protests on the streets of Delhi, when the threat for the symbol of Indian democracy is attacked and the national flag is insulted, these platforms have taken a different view and they are not suspending accounts despite of lawful government orders, refusing to comply with Indian law, and then sort of saying that we are trying to defend free speech. So I think the very purpose of this draft intermediary guidelines is to ensure that there is now a legal backing to ensure that these companies comply with the law and they appoint officers in Indian territories are resident officers, Government of India can take action against in case they refuse to apply with law.
That's a very important point you made. I'll now take you forward to the OTT platforms, Mr. Jain. As we all know that there again has been a lot of public debate on the nature of content being shown on a lot of OTT platforms. The issue even came up in the parliament where Mr. Ravi Shankar Prasad himself spoke of how a number of such channels are failing to self-regulate. So how does this three-tier system of regulation for OTT platforms work? Because the government today said that there will be a grievance redressal mechanism even in respect of these platforms.
There are a lot of complaints and there has been a growing concern over the content which is now today being made available and served on OTT platforms. See, these have been unregulated. They don't come under any self-regulation or censorship till now. Even the reputed platforms like Amazon, Hotstar and Netflix are mostly serving series and web content which is full of nudity, expletives, violence, abuses. And children are watching them. And then obviously there was a lot of complaints about the kind of religious trouble these OTT platforms and the series were creating. So what government has done, that government has now created a three-tier soft touch self-regulation system for these OTT platforms and the digital media news platforms, the websites which are running in the name of news. What they have said is that, look, whatever compliances electronic channel has to do under the Cable TV Act or a print publication has to do under the Press Council of India Act, the similar things have to be then now adhered to and complied by in spirit by these OTT platforms for video content or these news websites for stuff they're publishing in the name of news. Now, OTT, they are saying that, look, you can self-regulate. There is a code of ethics which government has now put in place that what should be done and what should not be done. They have to comply with that code of ethics in a self-regulating manner. At second level of regulation, they can form a federation or a group of self-regulating mechanism, like the TV channels have a news broadcast authority. So they can create an independent agency which can be headed by a retired Supreme Court or a High Court judge or independent person who can then oversee the self-regulation. And this is sort of an industry body and players can form it among themselves. Government will have no interference. At the top, government is saying that finally, we will have an oversight mechanism to look at these first two levels of self-regulation. Suppose if OTT platform, any OTT platform refuse to comply or serve with the code of ethics, then probably somebody can go to this self-regulating body of industry, file a complaint there. If they are not satisfied, if that mechanism is also failing for some reason, or if there is an emergency where content has to be taken off immediately, then this oversight mechanism headed by the Secretary of Information and Broadcasting can issue directions. Whatever powers government had under the Section 69A of IT Act to block certain content in India which can threaten our sovereignty, integrity and public order, which was done in the case when government asked Twitter to take down certain accounts recently. So what government has done, they have sort of divested the powers related to video content or this OTT platforms, etc., to the Ministry of Information Broadcasting. So they have sort of said that, look, for IT related issues and technical issues and stuff, Ministry of IT will deal. For content related to news or OTT platforms, Ministry of Information Broadcasting and the Secretary of Information Broadcasting will be the designated officer, and then they will follow the same process of law to ensure that these platforms comply. Second, very important to know that this is not a censorship. These OTT platforms do not have to take any certification from an external agency. All government is saying is that you start classifying content, what is suitable for 12-year-old, what is suitable for 18-year-old, what is suitable for 16-year-old, and ensure that a 12-year-old does not end up watching nudity or extreme violence, which is fine in my case, I believe. Second, government is also saying that all these digital news platforms which have suddenly popped up in last 3 years in thousands and thousands of numbers, now still government is saying that you don't have to seek any license or register with the government. What you have to do is that you have to sort of appoint an authorized representative of your platform or a portal and give his details to the government so that government knows who's running the portal and who can government communicate or deal with in case of any emergency. So that is the only slight amount of regulation government has brought in.
The rules, Mr. Jain, bar social media content that is defamatory, obscene, libelous, racist, harmful to minors, threatens the unity, integrity, defense, security and sovereignty of India and Indian ties with other countries. One issue that will arise is, which if you could respond to, is that this is a very vast definition of content and the nature of content that has to be barred on social media platforms, and that the government has arrogated to itself a lot of powers while defining such content. So how will that balance be struck?
There is no additional power government has created today. These are just guidelines within the existing law. And Supreme Court has also said that the right of free speech and the people's right to information and use these platforms to express their view comes under Article 19.1, your right to have free speech and information. And that then also comes along with Article 19.2, which is reasonable restrictions on free speech. So that is why all these issues of public order, sovereignty of India, relations with foreign states, they have all been existing for long for any platform, whether you speak on TV, radio or newspapers. Government has just said that they will also now apply on the digital media platforms. And this was already there in existing law. Government has just notified it.
Thank you so much for your time, Mr. Jain.
Thank you.
You were listening to a discussion on guidelines for social media platform. The participants were Jiten Kumar Jain, cyber expert, and Aditi Tandon, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on a mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com. This is All India Radio. In Surkhiyo Mein, now we bring you a program on budget for investment-led growth.
Hello and welcome to this special program on the Union Budget 2021. We are now joined by Dr. Rajiv Kumar, Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog.
Dr. Rajiv Kumar, almost, you know, two decades back, the focus was on highways and, you know, we know that Atal Bihari Ji focused on the golden quadrilateral. In the budget announcement, a record allocation of more than 1,18,000 crore rupees for the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. Would you say that it's again a renewed focus on highways and roads?
Well, a continued focus is a better way of putting it, simply because this government, since it has come into office, has continued the trust which Atal Bihari Vajpayee Ji gave to the construction of national highways and roadways and also to the Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana. The new emphasis is that along with the roadways, which have got 1,08,000 crore for capital investment, you've also got 1,07,000 crore for railway infrastructure, which is unprecedented and which will mean that you will get a new sort of modernized railway system for a new India by 2030. And similarly, as you know, that we have the flagship corridors, an expressway which will be announced for the, you know, for the national highways, as also for the railway, you know, the freight corridors, which will be completed by December of 2022, they will provide a huge fillip to the transport and connectivity infrastructure. And then the urban infrastructure, the two new schemes of Metro Light and Metro New, which will be more cost effective.
And now we are joined by Shri Ajit Kumar, the chairman of CBIC. Mr. Ajit Kumar, from the taxation perspective, how do you see it?
I think it's a very positive and a very growth-oriented budget. We are taking forward the Prime Minister's call for Atmanirbhar Bharat. What we are trying to ensure is that our industry, which had suffered a bit during this pandemic time, we try to protect those factories or industries where we can start manufacturing value-added products. So allowing imports of finished products or parts to come in, we have tried to raise duty on those where our own small sector MSMEs are capable of manufacturing these goods, so that due to this protection, they start manufacturing these goods within India. And wherever raw materials are required, we have reduced the rates because basic raw materials can come in and our industry can start growing. Credit goes to our entrepreneurs, to our manufacturers, that they rose to the challenge. Then we said, why not? If we give them the right atmosphere and we give them the protection they need, they can do wonders, and they have done it.
As far as rationalization of taxation is concerned, especially with the focus on indirect taxation, although, you know, GST decisions are taken by the council, can we expect, you know, some kind of rationalization in GST, and also those commodities which are outside the ambit of GST, like alcohol, like petrol and diesel, they also come into the ambit?
You have already seen the case of customs. A lot of work has gone in the last past few years, and around 4,000 lines on the customs side, we have rationalized this, the tax structure. So the intention of government is to ensure that the taxes are simple and that they follow a certain pattern. There is no inversion of duty, so that production can be smooth. That same philosophy of government is also there on the GST side. But then the mechanics are slightly different. We have to go through the GST council. The last council meeting also, this matter had come up and it was discussed. Only it was felt that it's not the right time now to do it. I'm sure in the next couple of meetings that will take place, these issues will come up for discussion.
Now let's go across the Chief Economic Advisor, K.V. Subramanian. Tell us, what is your overall assessment of budget proposal?
This budget has taken significant steps to provide fillip to that recovery so that in the coming financial year, India can grow really well, at least 10.5 to 11% in real terms. But at the same time, the budget, having been the first budget of this decade, has also laid important foundation for the Indian economy to grow at high growth rates of 8% plus over this decade. It has taken significant steps in that direction. There's been an increase of almost 140% in the expenditure for health. Do remember that health is a state subject, and so two-thirds of healthcare spending by the government comes from state government. So of the one-third part, there's been a huge increase from the center, almost 2.5 lakh crores provided for healthcare. And this has been provided both for preventive and curative healthcare, because the preventive part comes from sanitation, from clean drinking water, which has been provided for, apart from the curative part as well, where the 65,000 crores approximately Atmanirbhar Swasth Bharat Yojana has been provided for. The second related to that is the provision for vaccination, 35,000 crores. Vaccination is also a vaccine for the economy because it can really bring people back into economic activities, especially in the service sector. The second important part is the financial sector. Even entering into COVID, the Indian financial sector was facing challenges. There have been several steps that have been taken in the financial sector. The first is the creation of the bad bank in the private sector so that it can be effective. The proposal to divest 2 public sector banks and 1 general insurance company, the proposal to set up development financial institutions within the public sector and to enable development financial institutions in the private sector that infrastructure financing can be provided for, and last but not the least, the insurance FDI limit actually for the insurance sector being raised from 49% to 74% with necessary safeguards about residents being the managers on the board, etc. The third is the infrastructure. And the infrastructure is really critical. And here, roads, railways, and power have been emphasized significantly. Yeah. A 32% increase in infrastructure on a significantly higher outlay this year itself has been provided for. So when you put this all together, also add in the realistic estimates and the transparent budgeting that has been done, I think, you know, it all amounts to a dream budget.
And now let's go across to Dr. V.K. Paul, member of Niti Aayog. We have seen how the provisions have been made targeting the health sector, you know, 35,000 crore rupees for the COVID-19 vaccine. What can the people of this country expect to get free vaccination over a period of time?
Of course, very reassuring, first and foremost, and it demonstrates the clear priority that the government is attaching to getting the vaccine to maximum number of people, and also to make sure that resources will not be a limiting factor for ensuring this such an access. So this is, you know, a fulfillment of the promise which the government had made and repeatedly made, that the resources will not come in the way of vaccine availability to the people of India. As the chief economic advisor was saying, vaccination should not only be seen as saving lives, but also re-energizing fully the economic wheels and the social well-being of the nation.
Do you think now the focus will come back again on the healthcare sector, whether it is primary, secondary or tertiary healthcare in the entire country?
I think you can clearly notice that the focus on health is now central to the government's overall agenda for health, and to make health of the people holistic health, preventive, curative, rehabilitative, all facets of health get the required resources from the state. The public spending will match the expectations of the people in every facet. And therefore, you can clearly see this time around that push is visible, and this push is there to speak for itself.
We are now joined by the Secretary General of FICCI, Mr. Dilip Shenoy.
Mr. Shenoy, what would you say? We are talking about the fiscal deficit, you know, 9.5% for the current year and 6.8% for the next year. So how easy would it be to bring it down by almost, say, 50% from 9.5 to 6.8?
Well, you see, like, you also have to remember that we are in a V-shaped recovery. So if you look at the revenue points in the first quarter of next year compared to the -23% in the first quarter of this year, the numbers are going to speak for themselves. So you're going to see that. Second is also because the idea of presenting, and you know, the Prime Minister's idea and the Finance Minister's idea of actually getting the budget presented and getting the committees to meet and getting the budget passed very quickly is to start expenditure on 1st April. So that is a point that a lot of people forget. Earlier, you know, it used to take a lot of time to get the expenditure going and to go. Now it's going to happen from 1st April. And you know, very interesting that if you look at the PLI scheme. The scheme is already budgeted here, but all the action and the things will be finished by March. So you'll actually see execution of that and you'll see things happening. Most of the infrastructure schemes, they have been done in the National Infrastructure Pipeline. They've been identified. There's a dashboard going on there. So there's a full thing that there will be a revenue increase and, you know, that the fiscal deficit could be brought down there. But given the fact we are all talking in the context that the vaccination will be a success, there will be no second round of kind of a pandemic. There are a lot of things there. But, you know, again, the finance minister out of a capital budget has kept 44,000 crores with herself to say that we will use it to do other things. So there is very interesting thing to this budget that should there be something there, we are prepared,
prepared to look at it for financial year.
And also mentioned there that she's going to look at ways to incentivize the states to actually invest here. So that's the other thing that they're looking at.
So that's it in this program on the budget. Thank you so much for joining us. Goodbye.
You were listening to a program on budget for investment-led growth. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on a mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.
This is All India Radio. In Spotlight, now we bring you a discussion on budget and emphasis on health sector. The participants are Dr. Narendra Saini, former Secretary General, Indian Medical Association, and Aditi Tandon, journalist.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi today interacted with stakeholders in the health sector on the budgetary provisions for health in the Union Budget of 2021-2022. And as we all know that wellness has taken a center stage in the first budget of the COVID-19 era, with Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman clubbing various sectors of health which were earlier disintegrated and in silos. She brought them all together and announced a massive health budget totaling about 2,23,846 crores, and this was pegged to be around 137% higher than the budget estimates of the previous year. Today, Prime Minister also made a very strong pitch for the health budget, and he said that the focus of Indian health sector and the government push in this particular segment is going to be self-reliance. And he made a special mention of the new scheme which has got the major chunk of the health budget this year. And as we all know, the scheme has been called Prime Minister Atmanirbhar Swasth Bharat Yojana. It's a 6-year scheme and it will inject funding to improve primary health care in order to help India prepare better for any potential future pandemic. Let's listen in to the Prime Minister while speaking to stakeholders on the allocations for the health budget this morning.
Corona ne hame ye sabak diya hai ki hame sirf aaj hi mahamari se nahi ladna hai balki bhavishya mein aane wali aisi kisi bhi sthiti ke liye bhi desh ko taiyar karna hai. Isliye हेल्थ सेक्टर से जुड़े हर क्षेत्रों को मजबूत करना भी उतना ही आवश्यक है. मेडिकल इक्विपमेंट से लेकर मेडिसिन तक, वेंटिलेटर से लेकर वैक्सीन तक, साइंटिफिक रिसर्च से लेकर के सर्वेलेंस इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर तक, डॉक्टर से लेकर के एपिडेमियोलॉजिस्ट तक, हमें सभी पर ध्यान देना है ताकि देश में भविष्य में किसी भी स्वास्थ्य आपदा के लिए बेहतर तरीके से तैयार रहें. पीएम आत्मनिर्भर स्वस्थ भारत योजना के पीछे मूलतः यही प्रेरणा है. इस योजना के तहत रिसर्च से लेकर टेस्टिंग और ट्रीटमेंट तक देश में ही एक आधुनिक इकोसिस्टम विकसित करना तय किया गया है. पीएम आत्मनिर्भर स्वस्थ भारत योजना हर स्पेक्ट्रम में हमारी क्षमताओं में वृद्धि करेगी.
So, Dr. Saini, how do you see Prime Minister's engagement with stakeholders? Because it's a once-in-a-decade kind of a thing. When after the budget, you see the Prime Minister engaging the industry and other stakeholders?
Health has come into focus when this corona has come up. Otherwise, always health was a neglected subject. If I go into the health budget, it is 2,23,846 lakh crore rupees. But as you rightly said, it has been segregated into different departments which were previously there in different ministries. If you see Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, the previous budget, it was 65,000 crores. But this year, it has been increased to 71,269 crore. But if you see the revised budget which has happened in between, that was 82,000 crore. I appreciate the Prime Minister's concern in health.
Dr. Saini, if you go back to the National Health Policy document which came out in 2017, that document for the first time speaks about combining all various silo budgets for health under different ministries and bringing them together under one head. And this year's budget is actually an extension of the National Health Policy vision, where the previous practice was to actually look at health in a very segregated way. And if you heard the Prime Minister today, he did mention that this particular government is trying to look at the health sector holistically and not in silos. I think that is one reason why they have clubbed so many other segments and other ministerial allocations under the larger budget for wellness and health. But coming back to Prime Minister's pitch for Atmanirbhar Swasth Bharat scheme, today when the Prime Minister said that the Atmanirbhar Bharat mission and scheme is going to strengthen surveillance infrastructure, is going to improve India's self-reliance in drugs and devices, and is also going to create an infrastructure of public health labs plus critical care units across districts of the country, because COVID-19 has taught us many lessons and we have to take heart from those lessons and prepare for the future pandemic, because we are only as good as we are to handle the next pandemic, because influenza outbreaks will keep happening. They've always happened.
Yes. You cannot predict any pandemic happening at any point of time, and they will keep on happening. That Yojana called Pradhan Mantri Atmanirbhar Swasth Bharat, we really appreciate that we have to be Atmanirbhar. I think India has the maximum out-of-pocket expenses. If you see allocation of budget of USA, it is around 18%. If I say neighboring country like Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, this is around 5%. We are just at 1.3%. And secondly, we really appreciate, which you also narrated, that different headings under which is important part, water, sanitation, all this combining together into one head. I think Prime Minister is doing a great job, but it is the implementation people. They have to see to it the vision of Prime Minister is being implemented or not.
This overall budget also takes into account the COVID vaccination allocation of rupees 35,000 crore.
We really appreciate that as soon as pandemic has come in the form of COVID, Prime Minister has intervened. I really appreciate the effort of Prime Minister specifically. He intervened and he sanctioned 35,000 crore rupees. And the fruit of that we are now seeing. We have Covaxin, which is Indian produced vaccine, and we have Covishield also. I think that has really helped.
Dr. Saini, I want to take you back to Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman's budget remarks when she was making the announcement regarding health sector allocations. She did say at the time that the government is fully committed to enhancing the public expenditure in health and that money for health sector will not be a problem. Because the point that you made about the need for the government to keep expanding public expenditure in the sector is very well taken. I want you to reflect also on Prime Minister Narendra Modi today telling stakeholders to help reduce India's dependence on raw materials needed to manufacture drugs and devices. If you heard what he said, he repeatedly made a mention of four new central schemes, including production-linked incentive schemes for firms that are going to be helped to, you know, manufacture raw materials to further produce drugs. So this self-reliance pitch in raw material, what do you have to say on that?
We really appreciate that statement. But that statement has to be implemented. Problems comes in implementation. Raw material and equipments. You talk about the smallest possible device which is used in medical circle. That is being getting imported. You talk about drugs. We are making drugs. We are exporting. But the raw material of drugs comes from different countries, not from India. So for that, you need to have a research. And for the research, you have to fund them. You have to support them. So we have to really go down what we call it a root cause analysis. We have to go into the root cause analysis. Why we are not having research? When the government is spending so much of money, we have done high things in medicine. If you talk about our doctors, they are respected abroad. They are respected in the country. We have medical tourism. which is coming to India for taking treatment because, of course, they feel it is cheaper and best.
I think, Dr. Saini, that is the reason that the country is focusing on solutions rather than the problems. Going forward, you know, you just mentioned that Indian doctors are highly respected across the world. And that is something that we have seen in the COVID times also. And the fact that India has been exporting drugs and a lot of equipment like personal protective equipment and sending so many vaccines to so many countries. 25 countries have already received Indian vaccines for COVID and some 40 more will receive. So on that front, I think a lot of work is being done already. Dr. Saini, I just wanted to ask you also that Prime Minister mentioned today about COVID-19 experiences of India to be used in the eradication of tuberculosis, because TB is a huge challenge for the country and we account for almost 24% of global infections. And the mention by Mr. Modi in the morning meeting was that since tuberculosis is also a droplet infection and capacities that India has created during COVID-19 fight can help us in tackling, you know, the tuberculosis challenge. Do you think that's possible and that's a good way to actually address the TB challenge?
Yes, very much, because both of these two diseases, if we think about, if we analyze it, they are by droplet or they are airborne infections. So if we know the precautions of one, the other can also be taken care of. So tuberculosis, I think we have really made great effort previously also in controlling this disease. And really this, the experience of this will really help us. And the hygienic behavior in terms of air control and all those things, which we have learned during this time, and even now the common man also knows keeping a distance, having good ventilation in the house. These small things will really make us taking control of this disease, the government level, as well as from the point of view of general public. This will going to be making a difference.
Right. And coming to the issue of traditional medicine, Dr. Saini, as you know that the Prime Minister's comments in the morning were about the WHO setting up the first global center for traditional medicine in India. And the Prime Minister also said that Indian traditional medicine, Indian spices, Indian kadha have kind of gained some sort of global reputation during COVID times. And he did appeal to the Ayush practitioners to pay attention to research and undergo the rigors of research to actually produce quality products. So what is the way forward on this?
I think traditional medicine have a role to play, but only and only when you have done a research. Prime Minister has said rightly so, that you do research in this modern era. If you say scientifically, then only people will accept it. And world will love it and we will appreciate, and every allopathic doctor will love to have our traditional medicine being accepted in the world scientifically. And I really appreciate that WHO is going to put up, as you are saying, that WHO is going to have a center over here monitoring the scientific analysis of our traditional medicine. I think that's a very good thing. And our traditional medicine will go a long way in that.
Right. Now, finally, about the involvement of private sector in the implementation of health programs and in the absorption of health budget. As we all know that Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana also has a lot of private participation. Out of 24,000 empaneled hospitals, around 11,000 hospitals are in the private sector. So it is not as though the private sector is not engaged with the government in this particular implementation program. But today the Prime Minister did appeal to the private sector to come forward and, you know, partner with the government in a range of new initiatives, including the digital health mission, which he mentioned, and the fact that digital health IDs are to be generated for all citizens. And the PM mentioned that these digital health IDs will help in improving last mile accessibility to health services. So how do you look at the forthcoming participation of private sector in this particular mission, the digital health mission, and also in COVID vaccinations?
Whether it is digital, whether it is COVID vaccination, or whether it is diagnosis of COVID through RTPs and all those things, private sector is ready to be partner in that. But at the same time, private sector also need money. So somewhere down the line, the planet and the private sector has to sit together. So the balance is required.
Right. That's very well said, Dr. Saini. And finally, you know, the Prime Minister made mention of the four fronts on which his government is working in order to strengthen the health sector of the country. The first he mentioned was the focus on prevention and promotion of wellness and prevention of illness. The second was affordable healthcare for the poor, in which private sector is participating through the Ayushman Bharat mission. The third, of course, is the improvement and capacity building in the health infrastructure and human resource building, because a lot of district hospitals are being set up, new AIIMS are also coming up. And finally, a lot of government programs, including Mission Indradhanush and TB eradication, which are going to be very important in the times to come. And Dr. Saini, you also realize that because of too much of strain on the system which the pandemic has put, a lot of other health programs would need greater attention going forward, both of the public and private sector.
I think the four vision which Prime Minister has shown, the private sector is ready to be partnered with that, ready to be going with the Prime Minister. Let's have a dialogue on this so that it becomes sustainable.
Right. I think we'll just wind it up at that, Dr. Saini. And just last point that I wanted to mention, sometimes along with infusion of money into the health system, it is the commitment of the health workers, doctors such as yourself, and the citizenry coming together to fight a pandemic of this scale, which sails us through, and which is exactly what has happened in India, which has managed to have such a low mortality rate despite being the second most populous country in the world. So thank you on that note.
Thank you.
You were listening to a discussion on budget and emphasis on health sector. The participants were Dr. Narendra Saini, former Secretary General, Indian Medical Association, and Aditi Tandon, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.
This is All India Radio. In Spotlight, now we bring you a discussion on Niti Aayog Governing Council meeting and outcomes. The participants are Shekhar Iyer, political analyst, and Ruchika Chitravanshi, journalist.
The sixth meeting of the Governing Council of Niti Aayog was held yesterday under the chairmanship of Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The Prime Minister has backed private sector role in order to make India a self-reliant nation. Mr. Iyer, can you take us through what were the key takeaways from this meeting and what is the significance of the Governing Council meeting? This was the sixth one, we understand.
This was the sixth council meeting, as you mentioned, and there were six major thrust areas that were taken up for discussion between the centre and the state, with the centre being represented by the Prime Minister himself. And in attendance were 26 chief ministers, three lieutenant governors, two administrators. And apart from that, there were union ministers who are ex officio members of the Niti Aayog. And you also had participations from several chief secretaries and others. And the discussions were moderated by the defense minister, Rajnath Singh Ji. Now, if you look at the thrust areas, that gives us an idea of what is the key areas on which the prime minister, as well as the central government, wanted the states to focus on. One is making India a manufacturing powerhouse. The next was to look at the agriculture, which is currently in focus because of the three farm laws. And then the other was, you know, what should be done to improve the physical infrastructure, you know, across the states. Then to look at human resource development and see what can be done to further accelerate this development. And then looking at what kind of steps that are in the process or already being taken to ensure delivery of services at the grassroots level. And lastly, the discussion also focused on health and nutrition. Now, in fact, this meeting we saw from the remarks made by the Prime Minister, which were rather very, very frank and very candid. In fact, the Prime Minister mentioned that the fact that, you know, India has a lot of talents, whether it is entrepreneurial talent or whether it is innovative talent, there's a lot of talent. But when it comes to final development of products, we don't seem to be in a position to do what countries like America or Europe or Japan have been able to achieve. So therefore, the Prime Minister drew attention to the fact that a company like Google could have been developed in India, had that kind of enabling policy support was there at a time when Google became a big company. So he said that one of the ways we can create a situation where you can have enterprises like Google is to take advantage of this production-linked scheme. So that is the main thing. And for instance, he mentioned about the fact that geospatial data, which has been recently liberalized, if this could have been done 10 years ago, you know, maybe somebody could have thought of a Google-like enterprise in India. So even in Google, what is to be noticed is a lot of the human resource which is working at Google, you know, comes from India. So in terms of talents, Indians are no less in the talent pool, you know, their contribution. But what is needed is the kind of policy initiatives. Of course, the center has announced several policy initiatives, but the states also must also get into that what is called competitive and cooperative federalism. Look at, you know, policy initiatives that are broadly at a national level and see how it can be done at the state level. And even within the state, you know, the Prime Minister suggested, why not look at products that can be developed in a particular district or a district considered with all the factors that help in the development of a particular product. So each district a product. So similarly, each region can focus on what can be done best and with what are resources available and within the parameters of a national policy. I think that's a very interesting observation, and the Prime Minister particularly mentioned the several schemes that have been in operation, particularly for the MSMEs and startups.
Absolutely. It's a very intriguing question that why can't we develop a company like Google in India? Do you think that enough steps have been taken, and has Governing Council showed us some way as to how India can boost innovative thinking and then also enable the, you know, the whole journey from ideation to execution? How can states and center, as you mentioned, cooperative federalism, come together to make that a reality? Does the Governing Council talk about that?
Indeed, you know, the Developing Council deliberated on several steps, you know, for making India a manufacturing powerhouse. And with the Prime Minister also drew attention to the fact, most of the entrepreneurs have a common complaint, which is there is too much of compliance and so much of rules and regulations. For adhering to those compliances will have to be given. There is so much of paperwork even in a paperless situation. You know, you have to file a lot of compliance regulations. So what the Prime Minister suggested was, why not some reforms? You know, just as the center did away with more than 1,200 laws which were considered absolutely obsolete. Similarly, why not the states also undertake, look at this compliance burden. In terms of if you have been cleared a compliance at one level, I mean, there should be a single window kind of thing when it comes to a compliance, so that any entrepreneur who comes with bubbling with enthusiasm and managed to get an investor is not stuck in just getting clearances, you know, to start his startup. So that kind of thing should be avoided. And also we have to improve the logistics in terms of which is center already concentrating on speed up corridors, speed up railway network, you know, better air connectivity. And also keep focus on export. You know, the most important is we'll have to look at the untapped markets, because we are talking of the crisis in our agriculture. Prime Minister mentioned, so we are importing edible oil that is to the tune of 60,000 crore to 65,000 crore. Now, this kind of money we are spending just to import edible oil. Now, could not this be money be transferred to our own farmers if they were more and more into oilseed manufacture? As a suggestion, this was mooted. Now, for this, the states will have to do something. But if you look at it, some states are doing more than other states. And some states are refusing to even come into this on the plea that this is going to encourage private sector or there will be domination by some big companies. Because this is the same argument that has been used in the respect of farm sector laws also. So therefore, the Prime Minister mentioned particularly that we will have to see that, you know, the physical infrastructure should also move forward. Of course, several chief ministers come with their suggestions how capital investment can be increased, because the states always look at, rather they would always prefer that the central government, you know, bear the burden of infrastructure investment, because they cite their own source crunch. But from their part also, the state should be willing to show, you know, they are encouraging in infrastructure development and they are also entering into some private-public partnerships, improving last mile connectivity and then reducing the energy costs. So that overall, when a project is implemented, entrepreneur can take advantage of the central schemes and incentives and can get similar kind of cooperation from the state governments and from district authorities.
Export is one big area where we are looking to boost the Indian industry. The budget also has announced various steps towards this direction. What is the role of center and state, the whole cooperative federalism, in order to make this a reality, as you said, because a lot of these subjects, as you mentioned, health, etc., they're all concurrent list subjects. And when it comes to infrastructure also, as you mentioned, that states want center to bear the burden of the whole expenditure. So how are we going to resolve this situation? Because, as you mentioned, both have to come together.
Now, take for instance, when you talk of infrastructure projects, one of the biggest hurdles is the land acquisition. Now, we did see during the first term of Prime Minister Modi, the land acquisition bill was brought and it created a lot of furor. There was a strident campaign by the opposition parties. And finally, the center decided that the land acquisition bill, which was thought of by the center, will be the model bill. And the states can take it up. They can have their own state laws on the basis of that model, which is to make land acquisition an easier proposition for infrastructure products. I think similarly, there are other areas which the states can, you know, be an active participant, because today you have states like Bengal, for instance, which is actually, for political reasons, has not been able to take full advantage of many of the infrastructure projects. And since state governments are headed by political parties other than a party which is ruling at the center, often what happens is political issues get clouded. So this talk of cooperation, you know, the cooperative federalism gets affected. So there are issues like, you know, Odisha Chief Minister Naveen Patnaik pointed out, look, let not every issue be turned into a political battlefield. And consequently, everybody is, you know, looking at these issues in terms of that there is the luxury of time, that we can go on having these debates, whether ideological or otherwise. And while, you know, entrepreneurs are, you know, actually are suffering because they don't have time. And in the meantime, you know, when we are fighting over ideological issues and how to go about it, if, you know, one step is taken, we see sometimes some states are taking three steps back. Take, for instance, even the farm laws. See, after the central law was passed, you had states controlled by some opposition parties actually passing resolution or laws to counter the central law. Now, this is purely for political reasons. This is not a very healthy attitude towards encouraging innovation or encouraging investment. Because obviously, if I'm an investor, I'm going to get confused by central law and then, you know, some state laws being passed, which is supposed to be against it, though the finally the legality of all this will be settled by the apex court maybe sometime later. But in the meantime, as an investor, I've lost time and maybe I've lost enthusiasm. So therefore, I think the states as well as the central government must come together on some issues and realize that these are the best for our, for to take things forward so that the development is, takes place at a faster pace. You see, the Prime Minister used to say that if there is a single thing that is the solution for all our problems, whether it is poverty or unemployment or even lack of nutrition or condition of women or child welfare, all this has to do with the pace of development. So we need to agree on what are the things that need to move faster. If it is a legislative process that is delaying it, that must be speeded up. If it is want of infrastructure, that must be done faster. Whether it is accessibility in terms of water or other factors, then those things must be made easy, and state must look at it in terms of a competitive federalism, which is what the Prime Minister often says. Like, for instance, if it is a competition between, say, if they are trying to woo the investor to come and invest in their state, they must be able to compete among themselves so that they can offer a better deal. Now, that kind of attitude is yet to come because a lot of the states are burdened by this politics.
In fact, Prime Minister has made the case for the farm laws, where he said that farmers need support in terms of economic support, infrastructure and modern technology, which require reforms, and reforms are important. One of the important things that he's talked about is the role of private sector and that how important it is for the in the development journey of the country. And he said that we have to honor this enthusiasm and this energy of the private sector and give it as much opportunity. Do you think he's hinting at some of the laws and all that that create problems for the private sector to flourish in India, and probably hinting towards how the policy should shape going forward, especially in a post-pandemic scenario?
Today, the private sector has a lot of talents, a lot of entrepreneurial talents, and they also have exposure to a lot of financial resources, because the states, particularly the governments, are, you know, actually, I would say, they are restrained by a limit on their resources. So that is why this talk of private-public partnership is essentially is there, because what the public units can do is they can give you land, they can give you other things, but in terms of entrepreneurial talent, in terms of managerial talent, the private sector is more time-bound and is more outcome-bound compared to state-run enterprises, which are rather, you know, caught up in a lot of process. That's why Prime Minister keeps saying, let us be, you know, more outcome-oriented rather than process-oriented. And that is his constant advice to the bureaucracy also to the state governments. I mean, look at what is the final shape of things that is going to come, rather than getting caught in rules, regulations and things like that. And also, see, some states have done very well. If you look at Tamil Nadu or Karnataka, even say Kerala, because they have been actually competing with some other states, which is actually what is called the competing federalism, trying to woo investors. But this practice has to become more widespread. And every state should also try to emulate the best practices that they notice in other states. So therefore, the whole idea should be, see, that what is our goal? Now, the goal is that we need to take advantage of this post-pandemic situation where old ways of doing things no longer work. But new ways will have to be thought of very quickly and adapted, because we will have to transform. We have to innovate and transform. Then only we will be able to perform and meet our objectives. And particularly, even if our objective is to create jobs. And that was the basic message of this Governing Council's deliberations.
Thank you so much, Mr. Iyer, for joining us today and sharing your thoughts.
Thank you very much, Ruchika.
You were listening to a discussion on Niti Aayog Governing Council meeting and outcomes. The participants were Shekhar Iyer, political analyst, and Ruchika Chitravanshi, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website, newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsttalks@gmail.com.